Alright, so I go first? Alright. Troops should go to the Congo, even though we're in a lot of debt. Lives are more important than how much debt we're in. The Congo is a large supplier of natural resources for the U.S. and many other countries, and the Congo needs our help. If we were in the same situation the Congo was, we would want help too.
Helping the Congo is a choice, but whether we choose to or not depends on the facts. The facts are that our government does not have money or the stability to fix another country's problems when we can't fix our own. Helping the Congo could cause further debt, more deaths, and make us a big target to starting more problems.
Okay, first argument.
Okay, I think all countries should help each other out. With that being said, one country could help another country out financially, and that country could pay back its debt and eventually pay back the country who loaned them the money. Also, when a country has money loaned to them, it will help thousands and millions of hungry people and people in need. And if countries could have each other's back when they're in need, there won't be any need for war, leading to saving billions of dollars each year. Countries need to help each other out and be friends, not enemies.
Going over to the Congo would be an endangerment to our U.S. troops. According to Statistic Brain, 58,209 U.S. troops were killed in Vietnam War. In the Afghanistan War, 1,803 troops were killed. In the Iraq War, 4,800 troops were killed. If we send troops over, we'd have just as many troops killed. Also, if we were over there, then we could be attacked, and that would just endanger the U.S.
Second argument.
The Congo is a very valuable country to the United States. It is a leading trade partner with the U.S., according to the Office of United States Trade Representative website. On average, the United States gets $2.4 billion worth of oil and rubber from the Congo a year. The sudden crisis in Congo right now could affect our trade with Congo forever if it is not stopped. Can you imagine not having enough rubber or oil for new cars or bikes in America? No, those are everyday necessities for American life. If we send troops over to help, they'll not only stop the war, but help the raw mineral production continue, which will benefit us in the long run.
Fox News stated that a United Nations peacekeeping mission in the Democratic Republic of the Congo, which has so far spent $12.8 billion, has changed by critics with the impetude and willingness to protect civilians from murder, rape, and other atrocities. If we continue to fund help for the Congo, our country and other countries may even become further in debt. This brings us to the idea of not being able to fund the safety of our country. Sending our military to another country puts a big X right on our government, money, military, weapons, and men. Why should we help the Congo when there are dozens of other countries who need help? The Congo isn't one of our major import-export countries. We could receive more valuables and goods from other countries.
According to CNN, money shouldn't be a factor when people's lives are in danger. King Leopold was the leader of Congo from 1865 to 1909. Leopold was a sick man. He turned Congo from being free into a labor camp. Leopold contributed to an estimated 10 million deaths. Congo has still not recovered from this crisis. We need to step in and help Congo out before things get out of control again. We can gain important things if we save Congo. If we help the Congo, we will still be able to receive a bunch of oil from them, and perhaps the price of their oil would cost less since we help them out. If we help Congo in their war, then they might return the favor when we need them the most. Congo has many people starving, and most people don't have a place to live. Most of the Congo people are being forced to leave or die because of the militia's force. Congo's people have the option to stay and die or walk away from everything they have. We need to help Congo out. The debt that we have is not a factor at a time like this.
In the U.S., we have a lot of problems. The U.S. is about $16 trillion in debt, according to the Concord Coalition. With the $656 billion that we directly spent to the Iraq War since 2003, we could have manufactured public structures such as bridges, roads, airports, railroads, schools, parks, and water or sewage systems. Or we could have paid for college education for every high school student graduate for the next decade, or eliminate hunger worldwide. According to GoneGlobal.com, in 2004, we had a total of $22 billion in property damage from the hurricanes and earthquakes. John Kerry, a United States Senator of Massachusetts, said that the U.S. is in an economic crisis right now and that our housing market has almost collapsed.
Rebuttal conference, 1 minute.
We may be in debt, but you need to think this through. What if your family lived in Congo? Wouldn't you want the United States to help out? I sure would. The Congo people need us. They are one of the poorest countries, and they have a very limited protection. The United Nations isn't really involved with Congo. Because the United Nations are not involved, there are many killings and rapes that happen. But there's nobody to stop them from happening. If we enter Congo and help them out, less killings and rapes will happen. We can help another country and somewhat benefit because of helping them.
There are a total of 192 total nations in the United Nations, so why does the United States have to come and help you guys? To become a member of the United Nations, a member must agree to the terms and policies that are in the Charter of the UN. It states that the country must be able to follow the duties and responsibilities that the UN demands. In fine print, these responsibilities say that each nation needs to do its part by helping out other fellow nations. So why does it mean that the United States has to do everything?
We think that we should do everything because of the fact that we're a bigger country and we receive oil and other resources from them, and they really need our help. And I don't see the difference between, like, if we send our soldiers out, I don't see the difference between our blood and their blood. I just think we should help them out because they give us stuff.
We owe so much money to China. Why can't China help if they, like, produce that much money?
That's China's choice. I mean, I just think that we should do it because we get the resources from them. That's all.
Okay, go first. I just wanted to make sure. My group and I went around the school and surveyed people and asked, if your child was kidnapped and forced into a militia and forced to fight during a war, how would you feel and what would you do? 10 out of 10 said that they would fight back, they would feel terrible and upset, they'd be angry and scared, and they would hunt down the people that kidnapped their children and kill them. Now, imagine how the Congolese civilians feel. Like, their kids are taken from them every day, and the children are forced to be in war. So many people are, like, dying. And the Congo helps us. They're a big importer and exporter. They import and export about $2.4 billion worth in oil. And we shouldn't have isolationism. We shouldn't be selfish just because we don't live there.
If we were to send more troops to the Congo and help them, the Belgium would see us as a major threat and shift their target to us. I'd much rather have the Belgium on our good side than have to fight against them. We have to think what is best for our country. We can't just spend the money we don't have to save people that don't benefit us at all. The United States should worry about fixing our own problems before fixing other countries. Do we really want to send more soldiers overseas? Families will have to go months without seeing their loved ones and not knowing if they will ever come back. I don't think saving people from a small country is worth risking the lives of soldiers that have a life and family to come back to. Besides, We are already about $6 trillion in debt. It's not like we can afford to send more troops overseas, let alone supply them.
We would benefit from helping the Congo because we would get more imports and exports from them, and more jobs would be created from the trade district. And you said that that troops would die. Well, isn't that somewhat sort of what they signed up for? They signed up to fight for countries and to risk their lives. They didn't sign up to sit around and play board games.
The Congo doesn't have much to export to us, so we don't have much to benefit from them. And sure, the soldiers signed up to risk their lives, but I'm sure a lot of them would rather come back to their families instead of die.
But if they did come back, wouldn't they feel good that they helped a country get out of war and benefit the United States by having more trade?
But who says they'll succeed?
Who says they won't?
Next. Everything that is going on in the Congo right now seems as if it's in a fictional movie. How could mass rapes and killings be happening in our friendly world today? They are happening right now as I speak in the Congo. Money shouldn't be an issue when it comes to helping people out and saving lives. The Congo has already proven it is very valuable to us with goods that we need every day. You'd think that we'd want to help them out. After several decades of violence, the Congo deserves peace, and the United States is in perfect position to help them find peace. Over 10 million Congolese people are begging for our help. If we don't give them, they will die with painful remembrance of nobody caring about them enough to save their lives. After this debate is over and the winner is chosen, always keep in mind that tons of Congolese civilians are suffering right now, and try living with a guilt-free conscience till action is taken and peace is restored in the Congo.
We as a group believe that the United States should stay out of the Congo. As I stated before, if we went to the Congo, we would lose our own troops and would lessen the security of our own country. Barack Obama in the 2008 election stated that he would fund more money to secure our borders. About 2,700 illegal immigrants cross the border each day, which rounds out to about 1 million a year. This number has not decreased since Obama said it would. Also, we need to stay in our own countries to solve the problems we have ourselves. We have a national debt that is topping $16 trillion, and going to the Congo will make that amount go up. CNN reported in August of 2012 that each year the United States spends $25 billion on foreign aid. People may say that if we don't go over there, we're going to be felt with the guilt, but it comes down to our economy. We can't afford to take that risk and lose. We also have an unemployment rate that is still outrageous. The Bureau of Labor Statistics reports that our unemployment rate is 7.9% as of January 2013. The money we would be saving by not going over to the Congo would give us a chance to develop new jobs in our nation. My group and I believe that it would be in the nation's best interest if we stayed out of the Congo, because we need to control our own problems before trying to solve all the other problems around the world.
The civil war in Sudan has displaced hundreds of thousands of people. The rebel groups want to take control of Sudan to install a democratic government. This is what they fight the Khartoum regime for. The United States' ultimate goal is to help all countries gain democracy. If more fighting was to break out in Sudan, the United States should go to help. We fight for freedom, and that is all they want to gain. The United States also has a war against terrorism. The Janjaweed militia and many people of power in Sudan are thought to be associated with the Al-Qaeda movement. If fighting in Sudan were to break out again, the United States should go to protect our homeland security. It is our duty as a nation to assist Sudan if civil war were to break out again, not only to help the people, but to protect our country.
Right now, America is $16.4 trillion in debt. This means to get us out of debt, every single person in the United States would have to pay $52,000. The bad part is that does not even include the $400 billion that the government pays in interest per year. Besides that, we have many murders that happen around the United States daily. We need to realize that our country needs help before we can take the time to help other countries. The death rate for the United States is 799 deaths per 100,000 people. That is more deaths than it should be. So instead of going to other countries, the United States needs to figure out their issues first.
Okay. Not only have there been 2.5 million deaths spread through the Civil War and the genocide, which has left many families distraught and scared, but also the acts of al-Bashir have led to another estimated 2.8 million displaced from their family, which is terrible, and leaves Sudan with the highest internationally displaced persons at 1.8 million people last year from the end of the war in 2008, monitored by the IDMC, or International Displacement Monitoring Program. But the displacement does not only affect those of Sudan. The people who run away from their families are also affecting nearby Chad, which is where most of the refugee camps are set up. Because the amount of people fleeing into the country is affecting them. So we know this because this not all happen at once. But over just a year, the refugees increased the population of Chad by 4%, which would be equivalent to Rochester receiving almost 2,500 people. It may not sound like a lot, but when these people need food, clothing, and other supplies, it will work its way up to being pretty expensive. So not only does the war affect Sudan itself, but also neighboring countries like Chad. The reason this is important is because it shows how the war does not only affect Sudan, but countries around it. It shows us that it would be beneficial for us to help Sudan, because not only would we help them and gain a stronger alliance with Chad and them.
Would you rather save 100 people now or thousands of people in the long-term alternative? I'm not talking about the lives we could save by going and fighting in a war, because wars kill people, and that seems counterproductive. No, I'm talking about the lives that have been saved and will be saved by medical research and development. Last year alone, the United States spent $56 billion on aiding foreign countries. That doesn't even include military assistance. Instead of spending money on wars in which we have no vested interest, we should spend money on funding medical research and ultimately saving many more lives. In the last 50 years, 7 major vaccines have been produced for life-threatening diseases. The invention of polio and measles vaccines, just 2 of the major 7 vaccines, have saved over 19 million people. That's over 3 times the population of Sudan itself. So we need to take a step back from foreign affairs and step forward in medical research. As for the United Nations, America is the largest financial contributor toward the United Nations. So if they decide to help, it's hurting us in the exact same way as if the United States was going to war.
One of the compelling reasons that if another violent situation were to arise in Sudan, we should go to help, is the Sudan's current president, Omar al-Bashir. Bashir has been wanted for war crimes and crimes against humanity since 2008, but there hasn't been enough witnessed evidence to persecute him. On March 4th, 2009, the International Criminal Court issued a warrant for his arrest. In July 12th, 2010, the International Criminal Court issued a second warrant, and with the combined list on both warrants, there was 10 counts against him. The issuance of an arrest warrant for Bashir offers the Obama administration a perfect chance to bring about a solution to the decades-long cycle of warfare in Sudan. The reason we have not been able to arrest him is because we've not been there to apply accountability to Bashir for his actions. If more fighting were to occur in Sudan, we should go to help because we have allowed a wanted and guilty man, to go free for far too long.
A reason why the United States should not go out and help the Sudanese is because there are many tribes and different villages that wouldn't like us fighting their own war that they started, such as the Darfur. They fought a very bloody and very violent war for around 4 or 5 years, and there are still several battles that occur, such as current raids and bombings, and that would be, we don't really want to get in the middle of that. And then they also have current connections with terrorists, and in the past have been known to be terrorists. And there's always that risk that we could get attacked ourselves if we go out to help.
The Janjaweed have been terrorizing the civilians of Sudan. They are linked to Al-Qaeda. The Arab militias have committed many needless crimes against innocent civilians. The government in Sudan have allied with the Janjaweed. The Janjaweed presence in the burned countryside and villages has driven many refugees to camps and settlements outside larger towns. The Janjaweed then pillage, kill, and rape the civilians. It was originally declared a genocide, but has since then been revoked. This is because the acts performed weren't with just one specific ethnicity. The killings were brutal and senseless. Even some of the own Janjaweeds were killed.
There are currently 15 United Nations peace operations deployed on four continents. There are more than 120,000 United Nations personnel currently serving in peace operations around the world. They are now the second largest troop coming after the United States military. We need to focus mainly on the United States and fix every problem they have before they should go to help other countries. Sudan has many problems too, but instead of helping them, we should help our country get in shape. The United Nations is known for peacekeeping, peace building, and conflict prevention. Why can't they do these for the United States? Instead, they would rather leave them hanging.
Okay, you said the money could be used for like polio and stuff. It can also be used for other things. And it can be used different ways it can be approved.
For what other things that would save more lives?
Defense programs.
What are those? You haven't said anything about how just two vaccines have saved three times the number of the people that actually live in Sudan. Also, the United States is $16 trillion in debt, so we have no right to be in the war with Sudan. We don't have the money and we don't have the resources.
Okay, even your group stated that the Janjaweed Al-Qaeda is linked to Al-Qaeda, and in 2001, September 12th, President George W. Bush claimed to have a war on terrorism, so why would we not be there if they're linked to the terrorist group that we're fighting in Iraq and Afghanistan right now?
Yes, but in 1957, the Sudanese, we made a peace treaty with them about 2 years before that, and they broke it. So why would we go and help them when they broke a treaty that we kept with them to keep frictions and tension from that happening?
They're not fighting with us, they're fighting with another group. So they're not, we don't have anything to do with that right now. They're not attacking us, but we're helping them defend themselves.
Earlier you said about al-Bashir, how there is no recent proof about how he actually committed these war crimes yet. According to CBSNews.com, we actually did send drones over there and watch troops that were linked to him burn down villages, about 47 villages actually.
But there's the reason that they can't find evidence is because there's a claimed civil war going on in Sudan right now, so they can't say that the president is leading the attacks because it's the two ethnic groups, north and south, fighting the war.
Thank you.
It is evident that if a situation were to reoccur in Sudan or any other country that has the damage that has amounted to what Sudan has experienced, that country should in fact send troops and supplies to help. Because if the situation were to arise, there would be numerous deaths that would spread through an already war-stricken area. Also, due to the fact that the United Nations are peacekeepers only and do not constitute as an army, and they cannot attack the people running the war right now, we need to send troops of a real army that can take out al-Bashir and his plan to run a genocide. Because he is in the International Criminal Court's top 20 list, and every time a situation causes, previously, the United Nations has separated Sudan, formed South Sudan, and we can't keep on doing this every time a war arises, because we can't just put a picture over the hole every time this happens. Because when we do that, who's to say the X couldn't continue into the new country and start all over again? Because the way terrorists work, they will go to extreme extents to get their tasks done. And as we know, all the militias formed in Sudan are simply not doing enough. They have been multiple hundred thousands of people raped, killed, and tortured just because of their religious views. Imagine when you get home one day from school and turn on the TV or radio and you hear that the United States have been overrun by another country. Wouldn't you expect help from someone else? And what's to say that our country's stability and another person's lives is more important than theirs in Sudan? So if you still don't believe that we have every right to help out in countries like Sudan, you're obviously not paying attention to the information we've given you today.
We should not help Sudan because we have our own poverty and our own conflicts. We also have our own economic crisis that we need to fix, so how are we going to be able to survive and send money to Sudan? If their soldiers are dying and their citizens are dying, why should we send our soldiers over to risk their lives also? If we do not fix the U.S. problems, we will not have any power in the future. If we help Sudan, we will fall apart even more because we are losing resources and soldiers trying to help others. If we help the other countries, it could turn around and they might not return the favor of helping us in the future. People say that going and helping the countries will keep us at peace with them, but sometimes the countries are just using us to get ahead. The U.S. is in debt at least $16.4 trillion. I don't know what you think, but to me that seems like a high number. All this money was going to other countries to help them. If we are in debt, why send the money to other countries when we need it for ourselves? We might not be a U.S. power in the future if we don't fix our problems first. We have as many problems as the next country, and we choose to help them while our country falls apart. We sent a lot of our jobs over to other countries to further benefit other countries, which has left a lot of our Americans jobless. Catherine Rampel from New York Times says that the unemployment rate has risen up to 7.9%. That's why we should not send our soldiers over or help Sudan.
The United Nations should go over the Congo if there's ever an incident that occurs, because why would you want to just leave helpless people to try and fend for themselves? I understand that the Congo has a military of their own, but it would be nothing compared to the United Nations. It is the Army's rightful duty to take on the task of helping other people out. They knew what they were doing when they got themselves into this. They weren't forced to do it. It wasn't like a regular person was just sent off to another country to fight for other people's lives. They were trained and had procedures to go through to know how to help people out. How would you feel to be someone in a country that was struggling and know that there was going to be no one to come over and help you? If the United Nations comes over, that could give the kids hope and the people hope. It could give them the feeling of wanting to do what they could to fight for their own lives, knowing that they were going to have assistance, it would make them want to do all they could to keep trying on their own, because there would be someone to be there to save them. If we don't go over and help all of these children, moms, dad, grandparents, etc., will die off, and we will have to live through life knowing that we could have made a change, but instead we just sat there and watched. So many people just sit there and brush it off like, wow, I would hate to be them, and then they just turn on their smartphones, video games, etc., like it's no big deal because their lives are happy, and right now they have nothing to worry about. As kids, all we are worried about is whether we're going to be made fun of at school or something. The Congolese people are literally scared for their lives every day. They are wondering and worried if they will make it through the day safely. We get it off easy. The least we can do is send the United Nations over to help the less fortunate.
I don't believe any of you understand the crisis our country is in. All the cuts on spending, the enormous hole we have dug ourselves in with debt. Our debt has become worse and worse each year as we spend more than we make with $16 trillion in debt. We don't have any money left, and yet we keep spending it somehow. Taxes rise, paychecks shrink, people are pushed to the brink, and somehow we all struggle to make it by. If we sent troops to the Congo, our country would be done for. Our military is very spread thin as it is, and we would be spread out across the globe as doing so. Our country would be susceptible or vulnerable to attacks, and the United States could become the new war grounds. It's a chance we should not take. We could also start a whole new war by entering the Congo. We can hardly keep our own country from drowning while in one war. What happens when two are occurring in completely different places in the globe, thousands of miles away from each other? Nothing about entering another country without permission is okay whatsoever. Our country would be furious if that occurred here. There's also the possibility of the United Nations getting upset, and it could even go to the point of sanctions. And how great would that be for our country? What if an embargo was placed on our country from a place such as China? According to Wiki Answers, 84% of the consumables in the United States are made in China, and for every 55% of the dollar spent goes towards some Chinese made. We all know that our country is not in the position to take this stand. We should think about ourselves before we think about others.
We have the better technology, and it is easier for us to get there because of our resources. We have the access and the opportunities to go there, so why don't we? We are a developed and an industrialized country, and they are poor and don't really have as much technology as we do. They do not have the access that the United Nations do either. It isn't a hassle and it isn't hard, so we have everything we need to provide us with protection and mobility to get there, so why don't we?
The war between Vietnam and the United States lasted 19 and a half years. That's longer than we've ever been at war with a foreign country, probably all of our countryship. It shows that we can waste lots of people in one war, especially those who are willing to fight for it. If we decided to invade the Congo to assist the Congolese who were going through hard times there, it's possible that we could anger those who agreed with Leopold's ways and supported him. In turn, this could spark an even more massive war and possibly another world war, which would be the third. This would result in more countries getting themselves involved in the fighting, spending more money, using up more resources, and killing men and women that we would send to fight. I know that nobody wants to see anyone that they love and care for have to go through something that they don't have to.
If we were to help the Congo now, they would be willing to help us later, because they know the United States was the one that solved their problems. The Congo has a very large amount of resources, including a very high amount of rubber, and it's one of the largest producers of copper. We trade many pharmaceutical products, poultry, machinery, and wheat with them, and the largest import with the Congo is oil. These things could help our country in the future. Maybe someday they would be willing to give us a helping hand. The Congo also takes refugees from many armed groups, since it is surrounded by many other countries. Because of this, it is a large source of corruption. That is why we should do everything we can to help them.
My main argument is going to be over all the soldiers that were dying at the wars overseas. And according to oni.eu, 109,032 civilians and soldiers have died between 2004 and 2009. And 66,081 civilians, 23,984 enemy forces, and 15,196 Iraqi soldiers. And this is the war on terror, by the way. 15,000 civilians violently died since 2003, and 654,965 deaths have happened between the years of 2003 and 2006. That's a total of 2.5% of the whole Iraqi population. The estimated number of victims from the war on terror in Iraq could range from about 100,000 to over 1 million people that are victims.
The United Nations should go over and help the Congo because there are innocent people dying. It's not like it's the choice of the people in the country to have the situation occur. If you were just a normal person trying to go on with your daily life, it would be hard to try and stop the conflict on your own. They need help. They don't want this to happen to them, so why are we letting it? If we have the opportunity to help, why wouldn't we? It's not just about us. It's about helping others out and making sure that everyone else is okay as well.
The U.S. national debt has become a substantial problem that affects all branches and areas of the country in one way or another. As of right now, according to the national debt clock, we are almost $16.5 trillion in the hole. It is at a steady increase, and every second it rises more than $50,000. Our current war on terror with Iraq and Afghanistan has cost us $1.5 trillion as of this year. Out of the federal budget, 26% of the money that we have is spent on protection and defense. Well, protection and spent between protection and foreign wars. If we were theoretically to invade the Congo and help the Congolese against the rule of Belgium, we would increase the rate by which the debt grew even more and assist in the piling of debt on the children today and the descendants of those children. Disputes with other countries has taken more out of our pockets than any other expense that we deal with. With magnitude of people that are in the Congo and the size of both sides that are fighting, the created war would result in years of fighting and draining of our funds that could go to more useful things. Money that could go towards a poor child's food or protection when they don't have anywhere to stay. Money that could go towards helping those who can't even afford a home or apartment. Money that could help those veterans who don't even have a place to stay or anything to eat.
Okay, you guys said that we would be invading them and we wouldn't. We'd be going over there to help them. The United Nations is meant to help people and get them to a peaceful state. We wouldn't be tearing them apart or creating more wars.
We would be creating more wars or in trouble, because if we went over there and if it was just a civil war, it could quickly escalate to like a war between two countries. And if Like, you guys, if we went over there today, and you guys, if our war, like, spread, and it ended up being, like, a world war, and they had to start the draft up again, would you want to send your husband over there if they had to choose him to go over there or something?
I would be more than happy to go over myself, if not send my husband, because the sense of accomplishment and your conscience, knowing that you would be letting people die over there when they're innocent from not going over there. And with the Civil War, it could happen, but the United Nations is there to stop all that and to make peace with everyone and not just certain countries.
And last time the Congo was imperialized by King Leopold II, the United Nations wasn't around and the United States didn't help at all, and they still overcame the trouble. And you would think differently about going over there when your family was torn apart.
But the United Nations and the United States could help now and greatly lower the death toll and the amount of pain and terror they had to go through.
But it might not lower it, it might just spread it out between our country and their country.
That could happen, but it's more likely that it'll be peaceful and they can make everything better and not just tear it apart more.
How do you know it's more likely? Is there a source?
No.
In fact, the United States did have something to do with the liberation of the Congo because they were pressuring other countries to get rid of their imperialized, what the other countries they were imperialized.
Your source is?
U.S. Department of Government. .gov.
All right. We should not send troops over because we spend $56 billion a year in foreign aid. And it's a risk we should not take because how do we know the Congo will return the favor? And if they're so poor, like Jonathan said, how will they help us with no money? And who's to say that what we do will even help at all? And how can we help when the United Nations does not usually authorize the use of arms or violence? And what about people that are dying here and in trouble here that don't have money and are poor, homeless, starving?
We will not be going over to the Congo and using power to enforce.
We will be
using diplomacy and helping them. Also, they're in a lot more trouble than we are.
Diplomacy isn't going to stop people from shooting each other.
It has before.
The United Nations helped many people before. They have been around since October 24, 1945. They have helped with Haiti, 9/11, Hurricane Katrina, and several other disasters. They have been helping countries out when they come across tough times for the past 68 years. The goal of the United Nations is to do their best in preventing war crimes, protect human rights, create conditions for justice, and help social progress. If that is their goal, and if that is why they're created, then why wouldn't we use them when we need them? What would be the point of having them and promoting all this stuff and the good that they do when no one was there to support them? We obviously have the technology and the resources and a good amount of people to help. If we all get on board with this program, it could really pay off. It could get other countries to become more liked by the countries they helped. Once you have helped a country out and saved them and helped them when the one suffering, it also gives you a feeling of accomplishment and achievement. The least we can do is try our best to save the ones we can, instead of just letting them die and fight on their own. If I was standing up here about to have my arm or finger chopped off or some other ligament, would you try and save me just because it costs a few pennies to what you already are in debt? This is what happened when Leopold was in rule and no one tried to save them.
If you were living in the country with the problems that they have, would you want to think that people are going to be there to save you shortly, or knowing that you would be left to die? Why wouldn't you want someone to come over to your country and help you guys out if you are in that situation? I think we all should.
The answer for the United States is isolationism. The opposing side believes that we should combat the evil in other countries with battles and fighting. Battles and fighting tend to lead to war. However, there is nothing more evil than war. If we go and help out all the countries with all the problems, war would plague the world. The war alone is more evil and causes more suffering than anything it can combat. We going over there wouldn't solve all the problems in a country. It would escalate the problems. Now, instead of a country civil war, we will see a war between two countries. The suffering that is caused by the nightmares of war is unbearable. It drives suicide through the roof. One active soldier dies every day from suicide. When I think of war, I think of two heroes, which were more than likely the two best men to come through this area and even in the top class of all areas. Sergeant Nicholas J. Patterson. Nicholas Patterson was a 2001 graduate of Rochester High School. He was among seven U.S. soldiers and two detainees who died in a vehicle accident in Baghdad. He was a member of the 82nd Airborne Division based at Fort Bragg, North Carolina, and was on his second tour of duty in Iraq. Nicholas died at 24. The second hero was Sergeant Major Jeffrey Allen McLaughlin. Jeff McLaughlin was a graduate of Rochester High School in 1979. He is deployed a total of four times, each time crushed the hearts of his loved ones. He was assigned to 152nd Infantry Regiment, Indiana Army National Guard, Marion, Indiana. He died July 5th when his unit encountered enemy forces in Orgunyi, Afghanistan. He was 45. They fought for the right reasons and were brave enough to do what others could not. However, I believe that if you ask their families, they would rather have them come back from overseas than to leave forever. That is what war does. That is the toll it takes. Tom Butler was a hero as well. He served in Iraq from 2005 to 2006. He was supported by his family, but the Butler family is very thankful that he is now home. War is terrible. More than 4,000 U.S. soldiers have died in Afghanistan since we went there. I believe that their families would also agree that they would rather them not be deployed and still be with them today. So do you want to keep putting families through this torture or stop it altogether?
The topic that we are debating today is whether or not the United Nations and higher powers should aid the country of Nigeria in its times of need. Our team is here to defend that the United Nations and higher powers should help and assist the country of Nigeria now and in the future. Nigeria is a country of great potential, however, the past has not done it justice. Nigeria possesses rich ethnic diversity and plentiful resources. The country's ethnic diversity has been the kindling of many outbreaks, but the plentiful resources have the potential and ability to bring the country to success. Nigeria is just lacking a strong government structure to lead the way. With our help, the country would be able to rebuild the government, healthcare, and education systems. Nigeria could become a civil, functional country. But without us, the country is going to be left for the dogs. Left to suffer wars, poverty, starvation, malnutrition, depression, murder, rape, abduction, cattle rustling, and much, much more. Yes, I'm aware that these things occur in America as well. However, the ratio of the occurrences there is to those of here differ immensely. The cries of Nigerian people are blocked from our ears by the selfish, careless society that surrounds us everywhere we go. We have to take authority and help the United Nations and other powers to assist the country of Nigeria now and in the future.
I am an anti-imperialist. I am opposed to having the ego put its tail ends on any other land. This wise quote was from an extremely wise man and author, Mark Twain. He believes that America shouldn't rule the world. He thinks that it is not our place to get involved with other countries and their rights. This is very true because sometimes America, when imperializing Africa in places including Nigeria, we could be just overruling the things that are rightfully theirs. Not only that, but we are struggling with many things in our country, the United States of America. There are so many murders, kidnappings, rapes, and so much more direful things that often come across unnoticed to the average American citizen. Many citizens do not understand how much this country is struggling and how we often stumble over our own works. What I think our country doesn't usually consider is the question, why should we go out of our way to help another country when our country is also in need? It is so peculiar how we find the need as a country to help another continent on their struggles when we very well have some of the same wants. It's not even about how much we are in debt or how we have enough resources, even though these are important factors. It's mainly how we have to deal with the same problems. Americans should not find the need to imperialize for very conspicuous reasons that are going to be conveyed throughout our different arguments. Some of these several reasons include our outrageous debt, risking the lives of our people, and our different problems we have in America, as well as many difficulties that pull down our country as a whole.
Nigeria supplies America and many other larger countries with natural resources such as oil and natural gas. But Nigeria does not just have oil, but it has many other natural resources that many higher power countries need. But Nigeria does supply the world with more oil than any other country in Africa. And in 2011 alone, Nigeria produced 2.53 million barrels of oil per day. However, this is far under the maximum amount they are capable of producing, which is an outstanding 3 million barrels of oil per day. Nigeria does not only have the largest oil reserves, but they also have the largest amount of natural gas. And Nigeria is also the 44th largest exporting market for America, and that was in 2011. And Nigeria is the 16th largest supplier of goods, such as oil or natural gas. And us Americans traded $33.7 billion worth of goods, which consists of oil, natural gas, cocoa, and rubber. And the U.S. Department of Trade says that Nigeria is the most important country in the sub-Saharan Africa. And if we don't get on good terms with them, as the availabilities of these natural resources go down, the prices go up, we may not be able to get these.
The United States are in debt $16,433,791,850,294 as of February 2013, says ConcordCoalition.org. The debt continues to rise $3 billion every day. That's more than $51,679 for every man, woman, and child in the United States, says the FixTheDebt.org. Social Security is $2.7 trillion in the black back in November 2012, and only $1.2 trillion is owed to China as of November 2012, says ZFax.com.
Next item.
Biafran war took a major toll on the Nigerians. It's quite obvious to assume that the fact that if another war were to happen tomorrow in Nigeria, like the Biafran war, that the falling statistics would most likely happen again. For one, there was at least 1 million soldiers who had died fighting in combat during the war. If they didn't die, then they were most likely limbless when they came home. Another 2 million civilians, mostly Igbo and children, had died from severe malnutrition, which is just a fancy word for starving. Then at least another 500,000 died from vitamin deficiency diseases such as kwashiorkor. Overall, an estimated 3 million people had died during the war from famine, various diseases, and conflict. Many civilians on both sides also had to be forced to flee from their homes. And while they were on the run, people would loot their homes, stealing anything that they deemed to be valuable. Lastly, there were 19 million Nigerians in poverty at the end of the war, and soldiers and full families were forced to live out on the streets. All this could easily have been prevented if we helped Nigeria out.
America has very many things on its plate, not only having to deal with our country, but trying to solve problems in other countries too. Our economy has downfallen in the last couple of years dramatically. We cannot handle trying to raise our economy up and also trying to help theirs. It would take way too much money and would later make our economy even worse. Not only does it put our troops in jeopardy, it leaves our country more susceptible to an attack at any time. With our troops in other countries, an attack could happen here, which could leave us not as armed as we could be. Why should we risk the lives of our people when it's not in our time of need? Before we help the Nigerians, we should fix our problems. Not only does imperialism for Nigeria hurt our amount of armed forces, but it also affects our soldiers, when we could be helping out in our own country with fixing our obviously great amount of tragedies and devastations. Also, it could risk the lives of our soldiers by sending them over to imperialize. It is said that more soldiers in some wars commit suicide while they're on call. According to Fox News, suicide totals have exceeded U.S. combat deaths in Afghanistan in earlier periods, including for the full years in 2008 and 2009, even though this pattern varies. We, as the United States of America, are a greatly protected country. However, with more and more soldiers being deployed to imperialize, there are less and less safety provided and armed troops available for the protection of our country. It is important that we as a country realize that we need to not make troops as susceptible to risks. We need them for our safety because year after year, the United States economy, greatness, and safety provided for our citizens get worse year after year.
President Barack Obama has high hopes for Nigeria. He recently declared the country as the world's next economic success story. As a result, his administration plans to help Nigeria build strong democratic institutions and remove constraints to trade and investment through the African Growth and Opportunity. If we support the country of Nigeria now, in their time of need, we'll be on good terms with Nigeria when they become an economic success. Being on good terms with Nigeria would be an advantage for our country because of their abundance of natural resources, as well as having another ally for any events in the future. The fact of the matter is that we're not just handing Nigeria the financial support to rebuild their country. We're teaching them how to set up the government systems and techniques that are necessary to create and maintain a stable government and country. The United States plans to help improve the economic stability, security, and the well-being of Nigerians through implementing democratic institutions. This would improve the accountability and the level of profession in the security forces. Our assistance would reinforce the local and national government systems, build health and education institutions, support improvements in the agricultural field, expand the job availability, and increase the amount of clean energy available. We would be in partnership with the United Kingdom and international organizations to improve the government, non-oil-related economic growth, and human development to provide more effective support than any one country could provide on its own and to have a greater impact on the citizens of Nigeria.
Although many Nigerians were killed during the Civil War, many Americans have been killed because of various situations. According to Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, as of 2012, there were 16,259 murders in America. With the numbers of murders in America, it wouldn't be an ideal thing for American troops to go help Nigeria. The rate of homeless people is 21 people for every 10,000 people in America, which is a statistic from the National Alliance to End Homelessness. As of 2011, there were 636,017 people that were homeless in America. Having the high amount of homeless people in the United States that is present, it wouldn't be fair to help another country protect their citizens from dying when the homeless people are at risk of dying and they aren't protected. Any Nigerian is at risk of dying or being murdered, but Americans are just as susceptible to dying or being murdered as well. Our country should be helping the people within the country rather than helping citizens of a different country. Why should American soldiers go help Nigerians if it means risking their own lives trying to save others, which could result in increasing the number of murders?
You guys mentioned something about the debt of America, but the United States isn't going at this alone, and the other countries and organizations in partnership with us are going to help pay for it. And we're not just giving Nigeria a donation, we're giving them an education. And it will take some money as well as time, but the rewards are undoubtedly going to pay over the costs.
But why are we complaining about having enough jobs or not a good economy?
we import other things from other countries. This is just limiting jobs from American people. So why don't we just stop importing goods from them, and so then the people of America can have these jobs? Plus, if it's so bad there, why would we send our troops over there to risk their lives for people that they've done nothing for us?
The goods that we're importing from Nigeria aren't because we're getting a cheaper price or we're trying to take jobs away from Americans. It's because we don't have the resources here, such as oil fields and diamond mines or gold mines, and certain foods that are grown there can't be grown here due to climates. And the soldiers that are losing their lives there are fully aware of the situations and risks that they put themselves into when they joined the armed forces, but they choose to do it anyways. And as to the soldiers that lose their life while serving, did you know that only 58,220 of the 2,700,000 soldiers that served in the Vietnam died? This includes the 57,602 that died in combat, as well as the 618 that died to suicide, homicide, and self-inflicted injuries. So even though it is a great number and that each death is near and dear to someone's heart, it's much less than people think it is.
But why would we import something from a country that's so dangerous to our people when we could go import something that they have that we don't from a different country that is not in so much trouble with their own economy or the people in it with their civil war and stuff?
The importing's not what's dangerous. Going over there is what's dangerous. The importing hasn't hurt anyone or anything. They're just literally shipping us over goods.
Earlier you guys were talking about imperialism, but we're not just doing it for our own wealth. We're doing it for their sake as well.
But also, if we go over to help them and they have another civil war while we're over there helping them, wouldn't our soldiers be in danger as well as Nigerians?
That's why I would send them over, because of the civil war.
But that our soldiers would still be in danger.
Yeah, they would still be in danger, but they know that they're going to be in danger when they sign up. They're not going there knowing that they're going to be safe. So.
And also, what speech or conference did Obama say that Nigerian was its next great success?
Culture shock in Nigeria.
Yeah, the culture shock in Nigeria speech. And the natural resources that they have there, a lot of them we can't get here. So if we don't go and help them, then we're going to lose money. Some of you think that we're going to lose money by going over there, but in the future, we're not going to be able to get those natural resources. So we're going to lose those natural resources, and the other natural resources that we got to get from America, those are going to be up higher prices, which is going to be even worse for our economy than going to war.
But if we lose the resources from Nigeria, couldn't we try to find other resources from another country?
Yeah, we could, but that'd take just as much time as going to war over there, and that'd be just as much money. And what if, you never know, what if those countries are having the same civil war as Nigeria?
Then find a different country.
We may not have what we think is the best life. We may not have enough money, or not enough food, or not enough of whatever. Nigerians are a whole lot worse off than we are. He might go home tonight and have a delicious dinner. While several children and people, just in general, in Nigeria are starving, wishing they could have the food that you might not like, or you might not end up eating. We need to help these people, save them from the diseases they do not deserve. They have the natural resources that we cherish and want on a daily basis. We can fix Nigeria's problems because they themselves have given up hope trying to fix everything. Even Obama agrees that we can rebuild our government so it can finally be stable. As for safety, there's always some kind of risk when going into a war zone. And soldiers are no exception to that. But that is their job. That is what they wanted to do. They chose to join the military to save people and to bring criminals to justice. On top of it, we would not be alone. the United Nations would come to help, as well as many countries that are associated with the United Nations. Therefore, it would not be just us. Not to mention, there are soldiers who don't have to be on the front lines. Take Lieutenant Colonel William Ping III, for instance, who affectionately known to me is my Uncle Bill. He's currently in South Korea, trying to reduce the tensions between North and South Korea. His family lives with him and always has. He's been serving for some 30 years, and he's been to a multitude of countries, including Germany, Italy, and Austria. If we get people like my Uncle Bill over to Nigeria, then that would possibly reduce the tensions in Nigeria, and that could end up preventing a crisis or war from happening. To wrap this up, everybody deserves to have a chance to be free. And Nigeria's people can't even manage to live their lives daily without fearing that they may die from starvation, disease, or be killed by another ethnic group. Thank you.
Although debt and murder are huge deals in America, suffering of our soldiers is the biggest. According to UN.org, from 1948 to 2000, a massive 1,648 peacekeepers or UN soldiers died while trying to protect other countries. Why would we want to take the chance that our soldiers would be killed? I have no idea what it would be like to lose a family member or a friend, nor would I ever want to take the chance that I could lose them. You may think that this can never happen to you or someone you cared about, but even if they do survive the war, statistics show that there is a 7.6% chance that all soldiers that have been in active duty will have the chance of having PTSD. PTSD, or post-traumatic stress disorder, is a very serious disorder. It is a mental health condition triggered by a terrifying event. Some symptoms that occur are flashbacks, nightmares, and severe anxiety, as well as uncontrollable thoughts about the event. Sometimes PTSD never goes away. Some of the soldiers have to live with this until the day that he or she dies, but some just cannot take their whole life with PTSD. Today, suicide among active duty military personnel averages one per day. One soldier dies per day, not in the war, but at home. This is crazy to think that just because they might survive the actual war, that they're going to be okay. Veterans now account for 20% of America's suicide rate. I understand that we need to protect our country with soldiers, but why take the chance that horrible things are happening to our soldiers who have given their lives to protect our country and our freedom? So are you willing to put the lives of our people on the line to help someone that we've never even met?